All right, let's start the service, and we will sing Because He Lives. If you please stand. God sent His Son, they called Him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive, bled and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my sin. You may be seated. We'll have our church news.
Yeah, I'll tell you. Thank you. Okay, good morning. Good Sunday morning. Okay, we are looking at staying faithful for 2024. We're very thankful for that. Okay, and as it says in Isaiah, Mike is but. It's on. So Isaiah says, for those who trust in the Lord, they will soar on wings as eagles. And that's what we want to do. We want to soar in 2024. Give the Lord. Okay? And so what we want to do, this is all the things that we have that's going on. Methods of Bible study classes. Now that has been postponed for 2 weeks. Okay, so today and next Sunday, we don't have it, and the Sunday following, we'll resume with that class. It's a second section of Bible study, okay? But that's usually from Sunday at 2 o'clock to 4 o'clock. Okay, every Wednesday evening, there's a ladies' Bible study that's at 8 o'clock. It's in English, and so I'd like to invite everybody to join that. If you're interested, you ladies are interested in joining the Bible study, my wife is hosting it, and so get in contact with her. She'll put you on the Zoom class, okay? And so we have our English classes are Saturday for the children, are from 11 o'clock for the children, and on 6 o'clock for adults. And so if you know, especially being teachers and such like that, if you know people that the kids want to learn English, tell them to come. It's free. They can join in, it's a great time. If you know anybody at your job and such like that, that's interested. Now we have flyers, little tracks in the back that talk about the English. And so whenever we're going somewhere, and especially, I tell you what, like in the morning, if you go like the 7-Eleven, the people working at 7-Eleven, they're interested in it because they work with foreigners all the time. And we've given it out to our nurses and such like that. And they're trying to find time to come too. So if you see somebody, just give it to them and allow them to do it. So Saturday, children's ministry, 11 to 12, and Sunday from 10 o'clock to 11 o'clock. Okay, so we're excited about that. We're having a good group coming out. Parents are coming out, getting to know the parents, and that's an awesome thing going on. Okay, daily devotions, we're in Galatians chapter 1 through 6, so please be praying about that. We're glad y'all are back. You have come back home, so I don't think you went to the Olympics, but you're in the right country for it. And so, but that's every morning. We will have a Bible study. Okay, and these are our English classes that we're talking about for adults. And we want you to come and join from 6 o'clock to 7:30. And so all you got to do is call up the church phone and log in, or go onto our website, and they can log in that way. Okay, and so we are in the middle of studying the book of Philippians, starting at 10 o'clock for our Sunday school class. And so in the tithe, they're studying the book of Joshua. And so that's every Sunday morning at 10 o'clock is when our Sunday school class starts. Okay, and like we were saying, September 1st, we'll be starting back again, our second part of Methods of Bible Study. So if you're interested in joining that, that will be September 1st. Okay, sign language is every Saturday at 4:30 to 5:30. And so we have a deaf ministry, and we have deaf teachers that come over and teach sign language. And so it's a lot of fun. There's a lot of laughing going on. I noticed that. And so I have started coming down on Saturdays from working just to see what all the laughing's about. And so it's 4:30 to 5:30. And so as we talk about our offerings and giving in of our offerings, we can give with the offering bag, or you can give it to the Gruntai account. You can transfer the money over. I think probably 80% of our church does that. And so they just transfer the money over. And we do that because we love him and because he first loved us. And it shows our faith in the Lord as we give our tithes and offerings, and we see how the Lord provides for us. And if you look at one thing that we are most concerned about is finances. And when you can share with the Lord your finances and you see how the Lord provides for you, it just gives you more faith. Okay, at this time, let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for today. We thank you for your love and all that you've done for us. Father, guide us and direct us, Lord. Give us wisdom. Open up our eyes what you'd have for us to do, Lord. And Lord, we just be with the offering today. And Father, just provide. As we give to you, we trust that you provide for us. And Lord, we just ask this all in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
If you please stand.
Who am I that the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name, would care to feel my hurt? Who am I that the bride and morning star would choose to light the way for every wandering heart? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading. That the eyes that see my sin would look on me with love and watch me rise again. Who am I that the voice that calmed the sea would call out through the rain and calm the storm in me? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor wind.
If you have your Bibles, open up to the book of Galatians. The book of Galatians. Okay, there we go. And as the deer passeth by the water, that's not it. Okay, anyways, what we're talking about today, think about this saying, today is the father of tomorrow. What does that mean? Well, what we are today is the result of what we've been thinking and the way we've been living in the past. Where are you at in your life and the attitude and the actions that you have? Take, for example, those who act wisely today will have wisdom in the future to make wise decisions. And then you have the people on the other side of the coin, is that same thing comes with finances. You know, you have those who save wisely today. Well, they'll have plenty for tomorrow. Those who spend everything they have today will have little or no money for possibly on payday. And there's no way to avoid that. You know, when we think about it, you know, the poor quality and small quantity is a reward. So what you are today is going to affect what you have tomorrow or what you are tomorrow. You know, the nation of Israel had to learn this in a very specific and personal way. And so when the way they were acting in the time that the Lord was instructing them, and so they had to have the placement in a position where they had to have this blessing. In Galatians chapter 6, verse 7 through 8, it said, "Be not deceived, God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. For he that soweth to the flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption. But he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting." Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for today. We thank you for all that you've done for us, Lord, as we study your scripture, look at your word. Father, Lord, we just pray that you open up our eyes and help us to understand the path that you want us to go. Father, give us understanding of your will. And Lord, we just ask this all in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. So, when you think about it, it's the law of sowing and reaping. Now, this affects every area of your life, whether it's in your family, or whether it's of your work, or whether it's of your pleasure. And so, every farmer understands this principle. We reap what we sow. We reap more than we sow. And we reap longer than we sow. And we're going to talk about those three things there today. Because each of those parts right there, we reap what we sow. Okay? And then we talk about understanding this. All this applies to Christian and non-Christian people as well. Okay? He says, "Be not deceived, God is not mocked, for whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he reap." So when we think about it, the principle goes to everybody. You can't escape it. It's going to happen, either for the believer or the unbeliever. It's a law of life. So as we look at this, we got it? Okay. We have one finger up there. I think that means 1 minute. So we're doing well. Okay. And if you notice, as it had talked about it, it says here, be not deceived, God is not mocked, for wherever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. That is that's a problem that a lot of people have, and they indulge in their lifestyle. They do everything that they care to do. And basically, when you think about it, they're being deceived because they're not focusing on God. Either they don't believe the truth, or they somehow think that they can escape God's law. Now, I'm going to be honest with you. As a Christian, and I've noticed it, be honest, I've noticed it in my life. You know, growing up as a Christian, there was things that I shouldn't be doing, and I go ahead and do it. Well, when you know what you should do, and you do not do it, what do they call that? It's called sin. And I've explained it before. The word sin comes from an archery word, where they're shooting toward the bullseye. And originally it started off as sin, and they missed the bullseye. They called it sin. And we're missing the bullseye that God has set for us, and it's called sin. Therefore, when you look at it, when we know what's right to do and we don't do it, the Bible calls it sin. And so what you sow, ye shall reap. It comes from your past, it affects your future, and it is with you in the present. You know, when we first got married, when we first married, I don't know how you say that. It just sounds weird. Okay, in the beginning, when we were married, we were poor. I mean, we were college students working full time. Both of us were working full time. And the lifestyle that you lived as a single person went away. And you had, I didn't know what a bill was. I didn't have bills. I just paid for whatever I wanted from my work. And if I didn't have the money, I didn't get it. Okay? But when we got married, man, there's like house rent, there's like electricity, and there's not. I was living on college campus and afterwards, and then we moved in, and there's a lot of extra bills I didn't know. And we had to learn how to budget. And as we learned, we would write down and we studied about it, and we got all the Christian books on how to budget. Why? Because I was tired of looking for change in the couch or in our car because we were out of money, you know? And so we learned. There were things that we had to learn that what we were sowing, we were reaping. So we had to pull back a little bit. And we had to learn. And so it affected the way we did that. We still tithe. The tithe went out first. We had to work around the tithe. But, you know, tithe came first with the Lord. And the Lord blessed. And we saw that. We saw that in our life. And therefore, we saw it in our life. It affected our future because we trusted the Lord more. We will go further with the Lord. That's what faith is. Faith is trust. If you have a hard time understanding the word faith, say trust, because it means how much do we trust the Lord? The more you trust the Lord, the bigger your, not influence, but the bigger you're willing to step out, the further you're willing to step out for the Lord. To the point is that you can trust with the Lord with everything. And so when you do that, it affects your future to where you are in your present. So as the Lord was talking about it, and as the Bible was talking about it, in Galatians chapter 6, verse 7, we discussed that. And we'll go into it. The principle applies to everybody, Christians and non-Christians. You know, if a non-Christian person would read the Bible, they would gain wisdom. They would gain understanding. I remember as I was a plumbing foreman at the age of 17 and working with old people at that time to me were 40 and 50, and I'm part of the old group now. But I remember being a plumbing foreman over all these guys that were way over me. I was stressed, not in a Christian way. I wasn't stressed about being a Christian. I was stressed about leading a group of men that were older than me, old enough to be my dad. every morning I would get up and read the book of James, and I'd read the book of Proverbs and make sure I had it right. At the end, we had a great time, and we got the job done, and everything went really well, and had their respect, and I respected them. Why? Because I read the scripture for wisdom and tried to work. The James is an awesome book to read on how to work with people. And I was reading it. How do I work with people older than me? How do I show the proper respect and still be a leader? And so, you know, it's for non-Christians also. I had mentioned before that there's a Buddhist monk in Thailand. He's from Sri Lanka, actually. And one day he was coming and studying English with us. And he's hilarious. But he would come and study, and I remember teaching him, and we're going over the Bible, and during the Bible study, he goes, "Are we in the Gospels?" I said, "Yes, we're in the Gospels." He said, "Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John?" I said, "We're in the John." And I'm thinking in my mind, he's a ringer. He's coming in to start problems. And I said, "Okay, you know the Gospel." He goes, "Every morning I get up at 4 o'clock in the morning and I read the New Testament." He said, now this is what he said, "Jesus Christ is the greatest prophet that ever lived." Now that's an awesome quote. He just didn't know the author of the book. You know, and I would witness to him, and he believed all religions were the same, but we would talk about it. But he would read the scriptures, even though being Buddhist, because he knew wisdom. He knew where wisdom came from. So it's for believers and non-believers also. But as I said, be not deceived, God is not mocked. For whatsoever man soweth, that shall he also reap. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 10 says, "For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that every man may receive these things done in your body, according to that he hath done, whether it be good or bad." So when we look at the scriptures, we are going to be held accountable for what we've done. And so when we're accountable, when we're not listening to the Lord, or we have heard the Lord, we've heard the Lord, but we're not listening. What's that mean? We're not allowing it to connect with our heart, and we all will be judged on what we've done. So look at your watch, if you have a watch. I want you to look at your watch for a minute. Okay, everybody got a watch or cell phone that's got a timer on it? You got one? Okay. Now you look at it. My watch is off a couple of minutes, but mine says 9:28. Look at your watch and think, in the next five minutes, I'm going to meet with the Lord. What kind of crop would you show the Lord? What would you say to the Lord if you met with the Lord in the next 5 minutes? You got 5 minutes. What would you have to show to the Lord? That's what we're talking about. What kind of crops would we have to show? You know, the Bible explains to us, we reap what we sow. You know, it's a good thing if we reap what we sow. It's the good news. If we sow good things, for sowing becomes a good habit. But it's a frightening thing to sow before the Lord if we have sin in our heart. Don't think that you're going to be planting oranges and you're going to reap lemons. It doesn't happen. You reap what you sow. Exactly what we do. You know, there's some people that are probably listening in today, but there are some people that in their life, they are sowing the wrong things. People are into drugs. There are people that are in the disobedience unto God. There are people that are deceiving themselves, and they're in the sin. They're in the sexual sin, and they think God is not paying attention. But one day, they're going to reap what they have sowed. So many people, you know, it's an amazing thing to me. It's just amazing. I grew up in a family that smoked. Everybody smoked. They made their own cigarettes. I mean, that was just the way it was. And now smoking is harmful. Smoking causes cancer. And people didn't think it would happen to them. Okay. And so now you go into 7-Elevens, and where they have the cigarettes, they have a metal thing that comes down to cover it. Why? Because they're trying to protect the children that are coming in. They're not protecting the adults. They're trying to protect the children that are coming in. Now, what's even better than that, I think, personally, if they would leave the cover up, because on every cigarette package, they have this gory picture of a person who's got cancer, and cancer has torn off half their face, and their throat has got holes in it, and it just looks terrible, you know? But the people that are getting cancer from it are reaping what they sowed. And at the same time, they think they can get away with it. It's not going to happen to them. But it happens. It happens with anybody. People that were alcoholics. I grew up in a family that my father drank, and I knew a lot of alcoholics and spent time in bars and such like that as a teenager with my father playing pool and such. And I personally know that people reap what they sow, that they would go in and drink. And I can tell you three people that I know committed suicide because they had gotten drunk and gotten depressed, and they reap what they sow. They didn't think that it would affect them. So as we look at these things, you can't believe that you're going to be doing one thing, but and you're sowing one thing, you're doing one thing, and you're going to gain something else. It's not going to happen. And so we don't deceive ourselves. And that's the biggest problem that I have noticed, that we deceive ourselves, that we're not honest with ourselves. Now, in leadership, as I teach leadership development, and as I teach leadership development, I explain to people, you write it down on paper. And you write down your goals, and you write down what you're doing, you write down your habits, and if you want to change, you got to write it down. Why? Because when you write it down, it becomes concrete. There's something more stable about having it written down. And so when you write it down, you get more focused. Not, it is not so much emotional, but it's practical. And so if you look at my work planner and such like that, I have everything written down. It's transferred into my phone. It's in my notes. It's in it where I can check on it, to go back through it. Am I where I want to be? Am I doing what I should be doing? Okay, all of us are responsible for it. And the thing that we have to understand is we reap more than we sow. Not just what you're doing, but there's going to be more that comes in from what you're sowing. Look at Matthew chapter 13. Now, Matthew chapter 13, verse 3 through 9. Now, when we're talking about it, think about it. Why does a farmer plant a seed? I meant to buy seeds, and I didn't get around to it. I was going to give everybody a seed. But why do you plant one seed? Well, you plant a seed because you expect the harvest to be more than what you sowed. Okay? And so a single seed will sprout and yield dozens, hundreds of seeds. And even in the same way as with sin and righteousness, it's the same way. If you plant a seed of sin, there's going to be more than just that sin come up. And it's going to come into our lives. A small decision, whether it be good or bad, brings a bigger crop, has a more effect for either joy or sorrow. And so it's going to happen. In Matthew chapter 13, verse 3 through 9, Jesus uses a picture of sprouting seeds to show them that God's word produces good things in us. And the results multiply. So we're going to read it. Now, this is talking about salvation, but I want you to see about the seed and what happens. Matthew chapter 13, verse 3 through 9. It says, and he spake many things unto them in parables, saying, behold, a sower went forth to sow. And when he sowed, some seeds fell by the wayside, and the fowls came and devoured them up. Some fell on stony places where they had not much earth, and forthwith they sprung up, because they had no deepness of earth. And when the sun was up, they were scorched, and because they had no root, they withered away. and some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprung up and choked them. But others fell into good ground and brought forth fruit, some 100-fold, some 60-fold, some 30-fold. But who hath ears to hear, let him hear. And so the talking about the seed is the word of God that's being sowed, and the ground is our heart. Now at that time, Jesus would just give them the parable, and he wouldn't explain the parable to them. And basically a parable is a mystery that's not been unearthed yet. But in this one, Jesus takes the time to explain to his disciples what the parable meant. And so we look at verse 18 through 23. He says, "Hear ye therefore the parable of the sower. When anyone heareth the word of kingdom and understand it not, then cometh the wicked one and catcheth away that which was sown in his heart. This is he that received seed by the wayside." All right? So you have the farmer who's going around, he's sowing the seed. Some fell on the wayside. It did not fall into the garden in which he was doing, and it was caught away. He said, that's Satan. Satan is taking it away before it gets into the heart. It might be their work. It might be their family. It's something that Satan is really good at distracting. And he pulls our attention. When the Lord starts to work in our heart, he pulls our attention away. And so that is what they're talking about right there. Okay, Satan pulls it away when they hear about the word of God and understand it not. And so when we talk about the Lord, we have to make it in a way that people who never read a Bible or saw a Bible or done anything understands what we're talking about. Righteousness, sin. Some people don't even understand about the idea about sin. When we're talking about mercy, when we're talking about holiness, we're talking about God. You know, and in the beginning, people don't understand that. So it takes time to build. You know, for me, and I'll be honest with you about this, the first time a person hears the word of God and says, okay, I'll pray the prayer, I want to get saved, I don't believe them. I don't believe they're saved. Why? They don't understand. They don't understand who God is. They don't understand about sin. They don't understand about righteousness. Now, every time that I've led a person to, and it takes me a while to them to get to say, yes, I've changed my heart, my mind. I understand what you're saying. I agree with you. And so therefore, I will accept Christ. Okay? But everyone that I've done it with, they had heard about Jesus Christ before I talked to them. I had a young man on staff with me for 10 years. He's a pastor now, starting a church. And I remember him giving his testimony. And I thought, out of my pride, that he got saved. I was a person, well, I did lead him to the Lord, but he got saved through us. But no, he had heard about Jesus Christ when a Korean group had went to his school and did an outreach and talked to him about Jesus Christ. He said in front of me, and I stopped and looked at him. I thought, I never knew that. The Holy Spirit had been working in his heart ever since he was a child. And growing up, he had heard about Christ. Someone had sowed a seed. It took him probably 7-8 years before he got saved. But it was amazing. It was amazing to me. And as I started checking out, you know, people would come in and they would work with us and they would study and they would read the Bible and they'd say, okay, I want to accept Christ. And I would say, do you have a Christian in your family? Yes, my aunt is a Christian. Ah, there we go. There's got to be someone before me. Someone sowed the seed. And so the point is that there's some people will be distracted. They will not follow the Lord. When you witness to them and they don't accept Christ right away, and you're saying, why not? Because they don't understand. And it takes years, sometimes years before they do, before they get to the point of accepting Christ. And so we have to be patient with that. And so here it said, the wicked one catcheth away what was sown in his heart, this would receive by the wayside. And then in verse 20, it said, but he that received the seed in the stony places, he that heareth the word, and known with joy receiveth it, yet hath he not root in himself, but endureth for a while, but when tribulation or persecution arise because of the word, and by he is offended. Okay, so you have it here. So you have it where the man is going through, and he sows the seed. He sows the seed, and he sows it, and it lands among rocks. But what happens is when he accepts it, he receives it, but it's only shallow. There's no root given into himself. He's done no studies. He's not having a prayer life. There's no root, okay? And then when he starts having problems, when there's difficulties start coming into his life, what does he do? He goes back to the old life. He's offended. He says, because of that word, and by he is offended. He says, I can be living this good life here because he has no root in the word. And so, therefore, he's not saved. I'm going to tell you a secret for everybody. Just saying the words will not get you saved. Just saying the words and saying the prayer does not mean you're a child of God. It's when you accept Christ in your heart, when you accept Christ in your heart as your personal Savior, is when you get saved. You can say the words, and you can know the words. You can sing the words, but it doesn't mean you're saved. In the book of James, the Bible says that Satan knows Christ, and he trembles. It means he knows Christ, but he's not going to change. I have had so many people that we have led to the Lord in our English ministry, and in the very beginning, we were having people led to the Lord a lot. And I'm thinking, Thailand is easy. I see no problem with this. And then they quit coming to church. And I was like, I don't get it. But then I would meet them outside, and they say, Brother Rick, we said the prayer to be your friend. And I was like, I appreciate that. Thank you so much. But whether you're saved or not, you're still my friend. And if you really don't accept Christ, you're not saved. See, it's more than just saying the words. It's believing in your heart. Some people grew up in a Christian atmosphere, heard about Christ every day. Doesn't mean they're saved. They have more of an opportunity to get saved than other people, but doesn't mean that they are a child of God. So here it said that he that received the seed in the stony place, the same as he that heareth the word and known with joy receive it, yet he had not root in himself, but dureth for a while. But when tribulation or persecution arise because of the word, he's offended. Going on, he said, also that received seed among the thorns is he that heareth the word, and the care of the word, and the deceitfulness of the riches choke the word, and he becomes unfruitful. So what happened? He's saved. He's following the Lord, but the thorns come up, the pressure of the world that comes up, and the deceitfulness of the riches. So he focuses on what he can gain in the world. And so he applies his life and everything he's doing according to the rules of the world. And so therefore he becomes unfruitful. And God did not leave us on this world to be unfruitful, but to gain fruit for Christ. We do not do good works to be saved. We do good works because we are saved. And we give honor and glory to Christ. And so as we do good things, as we follow the Lord, your life will change if we don't allow the pressure of the world to come in. But 23 is the goal. As we look at the goal in 23, and I'm coming back here, but he that receiveth seed into the good ground is he that heareth the word and understandeth it, which also bear fruit and bringeth forth some 100-fold, some 60, and some 30. So when you look at that, when you look at that, we understand that when they sow the seed, it gains fruit. It gains more seed. And like it says, put forth 100-fold, some 60 and some 30. But every time we sow, we will gain. And we will gain more. In the book of Hosea, chapter 8, verse 7, it says, for they have sown them. I love this verse. I lived in Florida, and we've had so many hurricanes come through, and we moved to Springfield, Missouri, and tornadoes. You have never lived until you've seen a tornado heading straight for you. I have driven through, straight through, two tornadoes. And it is amazing what happens. And it says here, verse 7, for they have sown the wind, and they shall reap the whirlwind. It hath no stalk. The bud shall yield no meal. If so be it yield, the strangers shall swallow it up. You have sowed the wind, but you're going to reap the whirlwind. I remember Tammy was working at a healthcare facility, and they needed help taking the senior citizens out into the hallway because there was a tornado coming. And she asked me, she said, "No, can you come help?" "Sure, I'll come help." And it's an adventure, and I drive out, and a tree falls in front of my car. I'm not going that way. So I go around the way, and I drive through, and all of a sudden, it's quiet. There's no wind. There's no rain. I'm driving through the eye of the tornado, and I'm looking at it thinking, I am going to die. And I'm going through it very carefully, and then all of a sudden, the rain hits you, and the branches are going everywhere, and I had driven straight through it. And when I went to her healthcare, and I'm helping with the tables and the beds and such like that, we're looking out the window, and you're looking at the tornado coming straight. It's coming straight for you. And we're sitting there. This is okay. This is not good. And then you're praying about it, and everybody in the building is praying about it. Even the non-Christians are praying about it, because it's coming straight on. You can see it. And all of a sudden, it turns. That's amazing. We talked about it at church when everybody was together, and they talked about it where it was going through the back of houses. It was coming through the back of houses, and it was tearing up everybody's backyard. And the kids were praying because their dog was in a doghouse in the backyard. And they think, their dog is gone. Skippy's gone. I mean, he's going to go with the wind. And they're praying about it. And all the way through it, you can see every house is torn up the backyard, is torn down the trees and everything, and it gets to their house, and it jumps over the backyard. And Skippy is saved. You know, that's an answer to prayer. But if you sow the wind, you're going to reap the whirlwind. If you sin against God, there are prices to pay. Number four is we reap later than we sow. And I think this is one thing that gets people in more trouble than anything else. Some people are deceived because of the present seed does not appear like it's making an immediate crop. You know, they watch the seed and they watch what they're doing and nothing's happening. And so they continue on with what they're doing. Because for some reason or another, they believe that there'll never be a harvest. You know, it goes with your health. It goes with your relationship. It goes with your attitude. It goes with the way you work with at your job. But mainly it goes with the way that we act toward God. You know, we feel like we are the elected ones, that God's not going to punish us for some reason. God's letting us continue on the path that we're continuing on. What would happen? Nothing's happened so far, so I think I'm good. We have skipped the eyesight of God. Some crops we reap quickly. Others take a long time. But don't be deceived. You will reap. The season will come. And so we have to understand, by going the second mile now and giving more than is required, we will reach a greater dividend in the future. Galatians chapter 6, verse 7, once again, it talks about it. Be not deceived, God is not mocked, for whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. And so it takes time. It's a comforting thing. You know, it's the same way when we sow, like, for example, I don't know what happened to the picture there, but I had it where they just sowed baby corn, and they had sowed baby corn, and it's a snowstorm, and so you can't see the corn, but there's baby corn, and it takes time to reap what they've sown in the garden. The good thing about it is that God is faithful. And it's knowing that no matter if we work for the Lord in a difficult contrast, in a difficult season, God is faithful. And God is going to allow us to gain rewards. from what we have sown, if we're faithful to God. So as I look, as I had you look at your watch, and I said, in 5 minutes, if we were meeting with God, what kind of crop would we show to the Lord? What would we show to God? That's only you can answer between you and the Lord. And so I'd like everybody to bow your head and close your eyes. God has a blessing for us. God has rewards for us. But it's going to be according to what we have sown. God pays attention to what's going on in your life. And God will not be deceived. So maybe there's something in your life today. You say, Brother Rick, I've got a problem. You know, I'm sowing the wrong kind of seed. I'm following the wrong path. I'm not doing the will of God, what he would have me to do. It might be a little small thing, but you know these small things go in the bigger things. And so if we have a small problem in our life, we need to give it to God. We need to confess it to the Lord and give it unto the Lord. If we look to our life and say, you know, Brother Rick, I really never accepted Christ. I never took time to accept Christ. I know about Jesus Christ. My family knew about Jesus Christ, but I never prayed and accepted Christ as my personal Savior. I can't pray for you. It's between you and God when we give our life to God. So let's check our life today. Maybe there's someone in here that say, Brother Rick, pray for me. I've got some decisions I need to make. Would you raise your hand? Say, I'll pray for you. Thank you. Thank you. You know, there's decisions. We just got to humble ourselves in the eye of God and put ourselves in the mighty hand of the Lord, and the Lord will bless. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for today. We thank you for your love and all that you've done for us. Father, guide us and direct us, Lord. Give us understanding of your will. Father, if there's something in our life that we need to set aside, Father, we pray that the Holy Spirit will work into our hearts and Father, convict us, and Lord, that we'll be willing to give it to you. If it's something we've had for a long time, Father, Lord, we just pray that we will give it to you and trust in you and follow your will. And Father, Lord, we just ask on your name. Amen. We ask everybody to please stand.
Dismissed.